السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Just brother Abdi was whispering into my ears just right now that there is no dinner tonight. If you are here for the dinner, you better leave now. If you're here for something else, then stay here. Inshallah. Start inshallah. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. My dear respected elders, brothers, sisters, boys and girls, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Not very loud response. The rumor of no dinner started working quickly. Dinner is there, guys. Mashallah, you can smell it. Mashallah. So yeah. Rest assured, you will go back home, inshallah, you know, full stomach. Alhamdulillah, once again, we have this beautiful gathering. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I changed my position just to be able to see who is sleeping and who is awake, so you can take note of that. So, not allowed to close your eyes. Closing your eyes means no dinner. Stay up, stay awake, stay tuned. Inshallah, we will go out home, inshallah, with something in heart and something in mind, inshallah. One of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to cry a lot when he leaves his brothers. And then they asked him, why do you cry? You are going back home. You had enough of us. I mean, you should be fine, happy and excited because you are going home and you are leaving us. He said, I actually would like to stay with you. Why? Because as long as I hang out with you guys, you remind me of Al-Akhirah. But when I go home, they only remind me of the dunya. Once you get back home, why you are late? There is no milk. Kids are crying. You know, they are hitting each other. You know, we need a plumber as soon as possible. There is a leak here. There is a problem here. There is a problem there. There is a problem here. And you're almost about to lose your mind and go crazy. So this is always what is waiting for you up at home. Problems on the top of problems on top of problems. But we have to stand up for that. I mean, it's our responsibility to take care of our families. So being among the people who remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a privilege. It's actually an advantage that a lot of people don't have. A lot of people just go out and hang out for hours and hours and hours, and they get away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Though their mates and their friends take them far away from Allah. To have somebody next to you, close to you, that reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's an advantage, it's a ni'mah, that you can't thank Allah enough for that. Wallahi, you can't thank Allah enough for that. To have somebody reminding you of Allah and telling you, man, you've got to come to the masjid, you've got to do your prayer, you've got to be that, you've got to behave, you've got to do that. This is what's supposed to be, the way we hang out with each other, the way we get together, is just to remind each other about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the short life that we have here. We shouldn't have enough of this reminder. We are here for a very short time. We are not here for long, guys. Look at yourself at the mirror. How old are you now? How much of your time has gone? How much do you expect? How much do we expect? The Khalifa of that time, Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, he was the ruler of almost all the populated earth at that time. You know, far as big as from China to Spain. He was ruling this whole entire earth under his rule. And when he was making tawaf around the Kaaba, and everyone is just pushing away just to give him space, he found somebody standing by the Kaaba, doesn't care about him. He looked at him and he looked carefully at him. Who's this guy who doesn't care about me at all? And he found out that this is Abu Hazim, student of the companions. And he used to have a disability in his leg. They call him Abu Hazim al-A'raj, the mean or the lame person who got disability. And then he asked him, he started changing his tone. He was going to tell him off or ask the security guys to take this guy out of his way. And he asked him, do you have anything we can do for you? He said, don't you get ashamed of yourself. How come I ask you for help in the house of Allah? This is the house of Allah, man. I should ask from the owner of this house. He said, okay, fine. You know, you put me on the corner. I can't do anything about it. They finished the tawaf. They left the haram. And he met him outside. He said, okay, now you're not in the masjid. What can I do for you? How can I help you? He said, can I ask you something related of the dunya thing or something about the akhirah? He said, as for the akhirah things, I can't have any, I have no authority. I mean, I can't help you about it. About the dunya, anything about the dunya, money, you know, house, I give you something. He said, subhanAllah, I just come out from the owner of the house of the owner of the dunya, the one who owned the dunya, and I didn't ask him anything there. How come I ask the dunya from a bankrupt person like you? You are a bankrupt, you own nothing. And he looked at him, how come I own nothing? I said, okay, tell me, how much of your money you're going to take with you to the grave? How much of your authority you're going to take to the grave? Are you going to die different from other people? No, you will go to the same soil. Do you have special worms and insects who are going to eat you, but others have different type of second class of insects they're going to kill, eat them up? No, we'll be eaten all the same way. Subhanallah. Then he felt ashamed of himself and he said, asked him a question, which I would like to ask myself as well. Every one of you should ask yourself, why do we hate to die? Why it's not something that we like it or we don't actually feel happy about it, even talking about it? لماذا نكره الموت? Why do we hate death? Honestly. He said, that is a very profound answer. He said, لأنكم عمرتم الدنيا وخربتم الآخرة. فأنتم تكرهون الانتقال من العمار إلى الخراب. Because you ruined your akhirah and you looked after your dunya, you well established, you renovated, you take good care of your dunya. So you don't want to move out from a renovated, beautiful place to a ruined place, isn't it? Like if you are asked to move from your beautiful, nice house, well established, to a ruined house, collapsing house, would you like to do that? Of course not. Why should I do that? So he said, because you did not actually build your akhirah, you don't want to move out there. But if you have built your akhirah properly, you don't mind to move there. This is a bottom line, subhanallah. And then he said, he asked him, so what is the way out? If this is the case, what is the way out? Is there any solution? He said, yes. أحسن فيما بقي يغفر الله لك ما مضى. أحسن فيما بقى يغفر الله لك ما مضى. Do good in the remaining part of your life, Allah will take care of the past part of your life. If you do good in the upcoming part of your life, don't worry, Allah will sort out whatever has been done in the past. Subhanallah. So every one of us, brothers and elders, still has an opportunity that we can do good in the, you know, in the upcoming part of our life. We don't know how long is it, but the good news is everything in the past will be sorted out. Everything will be sorted out, inshallah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will just, you know, let go of anything and everything. I would like to share with you something very, 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 very significant happened to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it actually reflects to our family life. We all have families, alhamdulillah. You know, some of us are already married, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and the others are planning to get married, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, astaghfirullah al-azim. But anyway, every one of us should have a family, right? And this family is almost the center of our attention, center of our, you know, priority. This is our priority, and that's right. I agree with everyone that your family should be the center of your attention and center of your priority. That's it. But you got to get to make sure that you know how to run the show. How to run the show. And how to function properly so you don't get actually ruined by your family. Why? Because your family can be the cause of your destruction, can be your first enemy. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّ مِنْ أَزْوَاجِكُمْ وَأَوْلَادِكُمْ عَدُوًّا لَكُمْ فَحْذَرُوا. O believers, take note that from your families and from your sons, your children, you might have an enemy. Your children, your family, your wife might be your first enemy. So be careful. Take good care of that. Okay? Don't get me wrong. Don't leave now. Because if you leave right now, you're going to make a big problem at home. You go home and say, woman, Sheikh just told us you are my enemy. You are my enemy. You know, get lost, you and your Sheikh. La ilaha illallah. No, I didn't say that. Wait. Wait to the end of the show, please. Can be an enemy. Of course, they can take your hand to hell or heaven. Your family can take your hand to the Jannah and can take your hand to somewhere else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and our families. Allahumma ameen. One day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received a guest, and it was an extraordinary guest, no ordinary guest. And this guest, you know, had a conversation with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this conversation was recorded in the Quran, and until today and until the end of the time, we still read and repeat this conversation between this guest and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this guest conversation broke all the laws. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set up some rules and regulations when we talk to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He even went too far, too hard on the people, saying that you people, before you get to speak to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you need to give a sadaqah first. It's not for free, it's not cheap. Okay? It's not that, okay, anytime you just go show up and say, Ya Rasulullah, I need to talk to you. No, no, it's not that easy. You need even to give sadaqah. But Allah canceled this rule straight away because it was really hard for the poor companions. So these rules include, you are not allowed to knock at the door of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're not allowed to enter at any time to the houses of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if you don't get any prior permission before you go there. If you go there, make sure you don't go on the meal time. You saw? Meal time, don't target the meal time, because some smart people, you know, they know that Rasulullah take his dinner, you know, around 6 o'clock. And then they have something to say, to ask, or have a question. They go right on the six o'clock. Hey, Ya Rasulullah, I have a question. Okay, dinner is served. Come and sit down. Okay, alhamdulillah. And then finish. What was your question? Nothing. I better leave now. Forgot it. There was a man at the time of Tabi'in. His name al-Fudayl. And he was such a big eater. He used to eat a lot of food. His brain was just washed because so much food. And then one day the people asked him, every time we meet you, the only thing you talk about is food, 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 nothing but food. But you were the best friend of Salim ibn Umar. Salim ibn Umar is the grandson of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. How come you've been, you know, a friend of Salim for so many years and you haven't learned anything of him? He said, who told you that? I learned a lot from him. Really? Yes, of course. Okay, tell us something, any hadith, any story, anything. He said, listen guys, carefully. Listen up, everyone is paying attention. Yes, yes. خَصْلَطَانِ مَنْ فَعَلَهُمَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Two things, if you do them, you will enter the Jannah. What are those? I forgot the first one and Salim forgot the other one. خلاص, done. This is all what I knew. This is how much the food can damage the people's knowledge. So be careful. Subhanallah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a very special person, and talking to him was also, you know, very special privilege. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Hujurat, the surah I have recited, لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Do not raise your voice when you talk to Rasulullah sallallahu. You can't just go, hey Muhammad, come out, I want to talk to you. Or what's up? No, you have to lower your voice and you have to be very, very moderate in your conversation. But this guest went to Rasulullah ﷺ house, raised her voice against the voice of Rasulullah ﷺ. She argued with him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not scold her, or he did not, you know, talk harsh to her. Rather, he recorded this conversation and immediately revealed it to Rasulullah ﷺ to be documented in the Quran until the end of the time. Why? Because she was a family, an ambassador of families, you know, who have no chance to raise their concern to Rasulullah ﷺ. So Allah documented that to teach the man and woman, husband and wife, family, what could be the solution for all of your problems. All sorts of problems that you have at home, I will mention, list them in the Quran in this story of this woman. The woman came to Rasulullah ﷺ and she said, Ya Rasulullah, I need a solution. What was that? My husband is not a well-behaving person. He's such a kind of a crazy guy sometimes. Okay, all husbands like that. What's up? What's new? He said, look, he came back from work and he had a big argue with me. Then he left. He got angry and he left to the masjid. Then he come back again later and he found me still haven't finished my prayer yet. So he had a big argue with her and he left. He finished his prayer, he come back, she was still praying. She was praying and she's just like, you know, going in ruku' and sujood. He looked at her and forgot all about the big argue. He lifted the home and said, I'm not going to come back again home. You get lost woman and stuff like that. But once he is back home and he look at his wife, you know, something start, you know, moving inside him and he wanted to reach her and give her a hug. You know, say sorry. And she kicked him like that, get out of me. He said, you are just like my mom. I will never come close to you. She said, how dare you say that? I'm not your mom. He said, no, you are my mother. Right now you are just like my mother. I'm not going to touch you anymore. She left him and she went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, this is exactly what happened. What is the solution? That was a custom at that time among the Arabs when they want, you know, to kind of, you know, divorce their wives, or they want just to kind of, you know, kick them out of the home, or, you know, stop their relationship, terminate their relationship forever. They would say, "Anti alayya ka dhahr ummi." You are forbidden to me, same like my mom is forbidden to me. You will never become halal for me at all. You know, this is different from divorce, because divorce terminate the marriage, but still they have a chance to get back together, isn't it, right? But for the dihar, if somebody, you know, says to his wife, you are just like my mother, is it possible for a son to get married to his mom? Of course not, hashalillah, not possible. No. Never happen. True? Yes, never. Can anyone marry his mom? No, of course. No. Subhanallah. So Rasulullah ﷺ said, I think this is divorce. Because Rasulullah ﷺ never spoke out of his own opinion. He only spoke out of a revelation. Whenever he received a revelation, he would just talk. Sometimes, he expressed his own opinion, and some situation, his opinion was wrong. But that's not Allah's opinion. This is Allah, you know, his own personal opinion. So one day he was passing by some people who were planting palm trees. And they used to put like female next to a male. So when, you know, the wind moves, then, you know, these Polynesian seeds fly from the male to female, and then they get fertilized and then they produce nice ripe dates. So Rasulullah ﷺ said, why you guys bother yourself with doing that? I think just do it anyway, it will go very well. They said, okay. This is what Rasulullah ﷺ said. But they were professional farmers and gardeners. They know how to plant palm trees for so many years. But because this is what Rasulullah ﷺ said, they said, okay, we're going to do the way you want. And they waited for any fruits, no fruits. And then Rasulullah ﷺ came back to them after a few years and said, what happened to your trees? He said, they didn't produce any fruit, Ya Rasulullah, because we did it in the wrong way. He said, why did you take my advice? He said, because you are Rasulullah. He said, I was just speaking my own opinion. You know better your dunya. Whatever is related to business and dunya, it's your own way. But anything related to deen, take my words for granted. But if I express my own personal opinion, you may question me and say, is it right or wrong? Should we do it this way? You can bargain with me. And I will say yes or no. But when it comes from Allah, no question asked. So Rasulullah ﷺ said to her, I don't know the answer, but I believe this is a divorce. And you're not allowed to go back to him. She said, Ya Rasulullah, how is it possible? If I leave the children to him, they will get lost. He doesn't know how to even, you know, he doesn't know how to cook a cup of tea. I mean, he can't take care of the kids. And if he give the kids to me, I am not a working woman. I have plenty of kids, so they will get lost as well. So they either stay with me or stay with him. In both cases, the kids will get lost, will starve to death. We have to be together to look after the kids. He said, I don't know. This is what it is. She keep arguing with Rasulullah and raising her voice. No, that is wrong. It can't be that way. And Rasulullah doesn't say anything. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha said, I didn't know what is going on because I am not in a habit of listening to what is happening between Rasulullah and his guests. But subhanAllah, I heard Rasulullah after some time reading this surah, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ يَسْمَعُ تَحَاوَرَكُمَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah has heard the conversation of this woman, Al-Mujadila, the arguing woman, who come to argue about her case and her husband. وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهُ, and she complained to Allah because when Rasulullah ﷺ didn't give her what she wants, she said, I complain to Allah. Ya Allah, find a solution for me. You know, I'm not happy with this decision. I don't think our marriages have been terminated forever, but I'd ask you to help me out because this is my situation. I don't want my kids to be lost, and I don't want my family to be broken. Help me out with a solution. Subhanallah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this, you know, this, the ayat that comes, and which us give us the biggest lesson, because nowadays we don't actually use this phrase. I mean, I don't think somebody goes home and say, okay, let me practice dihar, something I learned new in the masjid. My wife, I have something new I learned today. You are just like my mom. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Get lost. It's a big disaster. You put yourself in a big trouble. Subhanallah. You know why? You will learn later on. This woman, years after Rasulullah was really, really old woman. You know, old people usually take their time when they talk. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was in charge. He was the Khalifa, the president of that time. And he was walking with his delegation, minister, security, and you know, in a kind of official delegation or official parade. And all of a sudden, a woman from the crowd, from the side of the street said, Umar! You know, calling him like that, he stopped everything and he went to talk to her. She took 1 good hour talking to him, and he was putting his head down like that and listening to her. And she was actually telling him off. Bakhin, bakhin, ya Omar. You know, how about, look at yourself, Omar. Laqad kunta Umayran wal an yuqalu laka Amir al-Mu'mineen. Used to be Umayr. Umayr means little Omar. I mean, back in the days. Now you look at you, I mean, they are the Mr. President now. Mr. President, go, Mr. President, you know, come. Look at you now. Ittaqillah, Umar, fear Allah, Umar. He was just looking his head. And when he finished with her, you know, the security people and the people were just kind of boiling in anger. Why do you stay listening to this woman and waste 1 hour of our time? We have no time for this kind of nonsense. He said, Wallahi, I take an oath by Allah. If this woman stood talking for 9 hours, one whole day, I wouldn't leave until she finished. Why? Why you have to listen to her? He said, because Allah listened to her in the presence of Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How come I don't listen to her? Subhanallah. And this is just an indication how we should respect, you know, the people who have a problem. We have to listen to them. Because sometimes the solution of any problem between the two parties is just because none of them wanted to listen. Everyone is opening his voice to the top. The volume is up and no one is listening. Both of them are fighting. So one of them has to listen. And that is why Rasulullah ﷺ was taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this story to listen. Because Allah said, I listen to her. Let her finish. Let her tell everything. Okay, so this is a technique between you and your wife. I'm talking to all the husbands here. Who look miserable in the law and the rajawa. You can see, no? Listen, man. Learn how to listen and do justice to your ears. Okay? One mouth and two ears. Okay? Listen 1 hour, speak half an hour, and listen how? Huh? 2 hours, okay? 50%. So learn how to listen. Sometimes one by the end of the conversation, she will forget what she was fighting for. She will forget what I was fighting for. don't worry, don't worry. Let's just go for an ice cream. It's okay, fine, no problem. Because I mean, this is one thing that we have to learn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away told the community and this person in particular something very, very simple and very easy for anyone to understand. It's not rocket science. He says, الَّذِينَ يُظَاهَرُونَ مِنْكُمْ مِنْ نِسَئِهِمْ مَهُنَّ أُمَّهَاتِهِمْ. I mean, those people who say this phrase, their wives are not their moms, right? Does it need, you know, a university certificate to know that your wife is not your mom? You know, how much knowledge, how many years you need to study to learn this fact? A simple man, simple fact. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to tell us that my wife is not my mom? Because he wanted to tell the people that some stupid people, they say some stupid things that don't make any sense at all. And that's a big crime in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because this big crime has a big punishment. You see, if somebody divorces his wife, what does he need to bring her back again if this is a first or a second divorce? Nothing. Not even witnesses. Just say, I decide to come and take you back. Finish. No question asked. Subhanallah. But look at this miserable person who take the zihar, who say, you are just like my mom. It's a big of deal. Why? I will let you know. It's a big of deal because he made something. Allah made halal, he made it haram. Anyone who makes things what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made halal, he make it haram, or the other way around, the punishment is the same. You see? If anyone put himself in this position, Allah made something halal and I make it haram, or Allah makes something haram and I make it halal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aggravate the punishment to the maximum possible punishment. Subhanallah. Like this one who came to Rasulullah and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I killed myself. How come you killed yourself? You're still breathing, you're still standing in front of me. Ya Rasulullah, I killed myself. Hey, come on, what happened? He said, I slept with my wife in Ramadan. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Can't wait until night time? No, wallahi. That's what happened. I slept with my wife in the month of day of Ramadan. He said, okay, go and sit free as slave. He said, I don't have money to sit a slave of free. He said, okay, go and fast 60 consecutive days. 60 days continuously, non-stop. He said, I am too sick. I hardly can fast one day of Ramadan. You know, one day of Ramadan is too hard for me. And you know, fasting in Ramadan is so easy. Fasting outside Ramadan is so hard. He said, okay, go and feed 60 poor people. He said, La hawla. Ya Rasulallah, I don't even have food for myself. How can I feed other people? He said, okay, I don't know what to do with you. Just sit down and wait. Then somebody came with a basket full of dates. And they said, okay, take this and go find 60 poor people and feed them this date. He said, Ya Rasulallah, wallahi, if I look for a poor person all around Medina, there is no family poorer than my family in Medina. I am the poorest one in Medina. He said, okay, take the date and feed your family. Allah can do it. Allah forgive you. Now the punishment here is so hard. Why? Because this person made something. Allah made halal, made haram. Allah made it haram in Ramadan. He made it halal for himself. The punishment is so tough. And the same, the person who tells his wife, you are like my mom, he made something halal, he made it what?
Haram.
Allah punished him with this severe punishment. You know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said? He said, this is, وَإِنَّهُمْ لَيَقُولُونَ مُنْكَرًا مِنَ الْقَوْلِ وَزُورًا. This is munkar, this is nonsense. And this is zur, this is fake, this is a big lie, subhanallah. Why? It is just because this is one of the biggest way to disrespect mother. And subhanallah, the status of mother is so high, to such an extent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named himself Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Two names. Because of the rahim, the womb of the mother. وَاشْتَقَقْتُ لَكِ اسْمًا مِنْ اسْمِي. He has driven the name Ar-Rahim, the womb, from his name Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. So anyone who actually violates the rights of mother, he violates the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanallah, Allah said this is the biggest crime to put your mother in this situation. And until today, in all cultures, I'm sorry to say that, the biggest offensive word is have something to do with the word mother, isn't it? Right? Listen, I want people swearing at each other. What do you say?
No.
Okay. Is the name of the mother is there? Yes. The word mother is always mentioned in any type of culture, any offense, like when people want to go really, really hard, really tough, the mother name is there. Why? This is really very severe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't tolerate it. That's why he said it's a big, big crime. And this is the punishment for this man. Okay, he said, okay, fine. Those people who do that, this say this word, he has to set free a slave before they even touch each other. The woman said, Ya Rasulullah, my husband can't actually do that. He's so poor. He said, okay, the next ayah says, who cannot afford to do that, let him fast 60 consecutive days before they touch each other. You know in Ramadan, how much we fast? One day, right? We fast the daytime and nighttime. Is it possible for a husband to, you know, go with his wife? Yes, of course. When nighttime, they can be together. He can be with his wife in the night of Ramadan, right? But when he has the zahar, he can't touch his wife until he completes 60 days fasting. And not only that, if he break his fast on the 59th day, reset the account, start from all over again. La ilaha illallah. So if he keep fasting 59 days, and on the last day he break his fast, sorry man, reset the account, the counter, and then restart again, before they touch it. Allah made it really, really, really very tough. Very tough. Why? Because he, by saying that, he put the woman in a very miserable position. He made her look really ugly, because, you know, just imagine somebody talking to a woman saying, you are now like my mother. Does it mean that all of these years we had this intimacy relationship and it's like my mother? I'm your mother? How? Just imagine somebody, you know, having this affairs with his mother. How? You can't even think about it. How come you say to me, but after so many years being together, you say you are my mother? You didn't know that until today, that I am your mother? How is it even thinkable? Subhanallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doubled and tripled the punishment. Why? Because of somebody putting himself in this position to put somebody in stress, or to make his wife put her in this miserable situation, or because of his, you know, making something halal, Allah make halal to make it haram. Subhanallah. See? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concluded that with something very important, and this is actually the bottom line that we like to reach. Look, when we had issues argue with our wives, and then we, after some time, we stop, we have a break, and say, okay, let's have a break and go do something and come back. Usually we forget what happened, right? You want to be smart, and you say something to your wife, and she replied to you 10 times worse than you expect, subhanallah. Don't be smart with your wife, she's smarter than you. I'm telling you, don't play this game. Don't think you can put her in the corner. She can put you under the table, you know? Not in the corner. So anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, forget, let go. Think of something else. Okay? Let go. Because whatever you say, bad things you say, and you don't remember, you always remember the bad things that she said. And you never forget the bad things you said. And she does the same thing. You know, she described you like shaitan. You know, maybe shaitan looks a lot better than you. And after you finish, she said, I haven't said anything, wallah. La ilaha illallah. You haven't said anything? No, wallah. He was offending me all the time. What did you say? Nothing. I was just quiet. I was quiet. I didn't say anything. She was going on and on and on and on for hours and hours. And then at the end, she said, I haven't said anything. Same with the husband. I haven't said anything, subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ يَبْعَثُهُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٌ. This is actually the bottom line of the whole story of the whole incident. When you are getting too in conversation, and too arguing, and too debate, or any fight, or any trouble with anyone, don't think because it's over now, and they forgot what you've said, and they forgot what you've done, that it's all sorted out. No, it's not sorted out. Because you keep in mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has recorded everything. Allah said, يَوْمَ يَبْعَثُهُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا. Allah will bring them back again to life, and He will inform them with everything they have done. Everything. أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ. Allah took good account of them, of all of these actions and deeds, while they forgot. If you ask yourself, what did I say in the morning? Can you remember what you have said since you wake up in the morning? How much you can remember of what you said? Almost nothing. Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know? Yes, it was all recorded, man. All recorded, 4K. You know, video record. Nothing is slipped out. Everything is precisely recorded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. So brothers and elders, here you go. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him in a very, very special occasion. And he announced that anyone who raises his voice to the voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be considered out of Islam. It's a big crime. But when somebody is stressed, when somebody in a very bad situation or in a miserable situation and raises his voice, it is tolerated even if he's raising his voice against Rasulullah himself. What it means is that when somebody is emotional or upset or frustrated and raises his voice, don't just stress on this issue. Let them finish. Let them voice out. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understand this is something out of hand. They are pressed. They are oppressed. Something is getting into their nerve. Listen and tolerate. And let go of it until they calm down and start, you know, speaking calmly. And then you start negotiating and, you know, arguing and presenting your case. But when they are onto the top of their voice or they are very upset and stressed, you better just let go and let them voice out whatever. This is the technique that Rasulullah ﷺ used. And also what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advised you, even if this person who raises the voice, again, it's the voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will be still tolerated. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows when people are stressed, when people are, you know, frustrated, when people are emotional, they are not aware of what they say. You need to be smart and you need to learn how to let go until things calm down, and then after that you start opening the door for a conversation or for any kind of, you know, argue if it's possible. Otherwise, you better just let go of everything and life will carry on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already taken a good account. Don't say, how come I let go of that? Don't you hear what she said to me? Don't you hear what he said to you? Yes, okay. We just let go and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of that on the day of Qiyamah. Just don't worry about it now and just let's move on in our life. But if you want to be judged right now and to, you know, kind of set up a court hearing for him or for her, then life will be very difficult for both of you. Learn how to let go, learn how to tolerate, and learn how to leave the case or to adjourn the hearing to the day of Qiyamah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows not just the weirdness, but he knows the reason behind this weirdness. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tolerated for a woman to raise her voice, again, it's the voice of Rasulullah ﷺ, because he considered her frustration and her miserable situation. How come Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do that and we don't accept to do that, subhanallah? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring, inshallah, happiness and tranquility to our families and to our wives and to our lives. Amen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring peace and happiness to our homes. Allahumma ameen. Before I finish, there is a brother who got his daughter very sick. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for her. To give her, inshallah, very soon and rapid recovery. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recover all the people who are sick in our community. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring an end to all the suffering and hardships of every one of us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and our families and our beloved ones from all sorts of evils and all sorts of difficulties. Allahumma ameen. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azab an-nar. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim wa tub alayna innaka antat tawwabur rahim. Allahumma ighfir warham wa tajawaz amma ta'lam innaka antal azizul akram. Rabbana ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna 'ala al-qawmil kafirin. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati 'amma yasifun wa salamun 'alal mursalin. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaykum.